Made in New Orleans is made possible by Art New Orleans Magazine, your one source for art, culture, and entertainment. More information is available online at artneworleansmag.com.
Good evening, New Orleans. I'm Steve Martin, filling in for our host, Maria Muro. Welcome to Made in New Orleans, an informative and educational TV series honoring artists in our community. Each week, we'll feature art professionals, artists, musicians, designers, and so much more, because we at WLAE are committed to keeping Louisiana beautiful through the creative arts. I'd like to get started first with Thomas Mann and his gallery, IO. We watched him work and talk about his art, so take a look at this.
Well, the style that I'm best known for is techno-romantic. That's a name I came up with basically in the early 80s to describe the nature of the work that I had evolved in the previous 5 years. And in college at the time, I ended up being a theater major, so I was doing set design and lighting. And I was really, really highly influenced by all of the Bauhaus theater designers and all this kind of stuff. And I didn't know it, but eventually that was going to lead into actually applying that kind of design thinking to jewelry objects. And so kind of in the mid-70s, I began experimenting with using found objects and plexiglass and odd materials and everything, and putting them together into pieces that really didn't look like jewelry at all. And I gave up polishing things and started steel wooling everything and producing matte finishes on them, and really kind of stepping outside the bounds of any kind of traditional reference to kind of jewelry making, because I'm really not a jeweler. I'm an artist working in the medium of jewelry. Now, one of the things I got out of those high school art programs was a really strong drawing capability, because one of the assignments we'd get on a regular basis would be to go out into the environment of our city or wherever and draw things, you know. And then we were taught all kinds of drawing techniques. So I've been fairly good at being able to depict what's in my brain on paper ever since. And for me, it's really a critical part of the process of being able to imagineer the eventual object by first seeing it on paper. The translation of an object in its prototypical form to a place where it can be made in multiples necessarily implies that there have to be exact drawings that you work from in order to do that, because everything starts at a small scale and eventually transitions to a large one. And I keep extensive notebooks of drawings and notes. Sometimes a notebook will just have a lot of words in it that will re-stimulate an idea that I had initially about how to put something together. Well, I get asked a lot by young artists or people interested in being artists about how to go about a professional practice. My advice to them is that you have to know everything and that you can't do it alone. And the reason for that is that I believe that the objects that are made by artists, craft artists of every stripe, are imbued with a kind of energy that is detectable. I actually believe that the objects that we make and sell as artists are representative of an energy connection that is made with the client, who respects that and wants to have that object in their possession, and it completes a circle. And I saw my gallery as being a conduit for that kind of interaction and connection. New Orleans has had an enormous impact on me as a designer and an artist, of course. I came here in 1977 to exhibit my work at Jazz Fest, and I've been at Jazz Fest every year since. I recently figured out that I've spent 3/4 of a year of my life at the fairgrounds. The visual environment of New Orleans is absolutely spectacular in its influence on not only specifically on the work that I do, but on the ambiance and the feeling of acceptance and nurturing. So it's one of the few cities, I think, in the United States that has already this kind of assemblage, kind of a look to it, you know? Because here you have, you know, you have Victorian buildings, but then you have ironwork on them that comes from someplace else. And so all of these kind of architectural styles were kind of all mashed together here and transformed in really unique ways. New Orleans, really what New Orleans is the primary incubator opportunity for artists, no matter what medium they might work in. Now, maybe New Orleans has a traditional reputation for the kind of work that has come out of the city, over the centuries here. Artists live here because they can afford to live here and work here. The work that's being produced here is as cutting edge as it is any place else in the country. And so, yeah, New Orleans, enormous, enormous influence on me.
Wow, we just saw a great piece about him, and now we have the pleasure to have Thomas Mann here with us. Welcome, Tom.
Hey, thanks, Steve.
Thanks for being here.
Thanks for having me.
What's been going on, man? What have you been doing?
Well, I've just returned from a trip to Australia. I was there for a month teaching and exhibiting my work, and that was very intense and wonderful.
How do you get an opportunity to do that?
Well, that actually came out of the fact that last October, a book that I had written for Northlight Press called The Metal Artist Workbench, Demystifying the Jeweler Saw,
right,
also was released in Australia at the same time. And within a month of the book's release, I was getting calls from a couple of different schools and situations there, emails and things like that, asking if I would be available to come and, you know, do some presentations or workshops. And it's evolved into a whole set of opportunities there, including an exhibition in Tasmania in Hobart at a gallery there that's been representing me for over 20 years.
Now, they've been representing your jewelry.
Jewelry.
Yes,
mm-hmm.
The techno-romantic,
yeah,
that mm-hmm. you talked about.
Yeah.
What kind of series of designs are you implementing now or working on now?
Well, you know, I've been very fortunate to actually develop a personal design vocabulary that you refer to as techno-romantic, and that is the name that I invented for it in the early 80s. And it's like if an artist gets to invent just one vocabulary that makes them popular and provides the income to sustain their ability to be around to be an artist, they should consider themselves very lucky.
Right.
Now, I've been very fortunate because techno-romantic's been enormously successful in accomplishing that. And so I'm now trying to reinvent myself in a couple of other different ways, sculpturally, jewelry-wise, product-wise, teaching-wise, because I've discovered that, you know, in the new century here, we have to really diversify our efforts in order to be able to make enough money to keep it going.
Right, and one of the interesting things that you said in the piece was you were an artist that happened to do jewelry, but you're also a businessman, and you have an entrepreneurial side, and you've put all these things together. So let's talk about the books. You've done the book that's real unique, and you've got another one that you've done and one coming out.
Well, I'm the how-to book, the Jeweler Saw book, that was the first really how-to book that I've ever done, and I'm hoping it's going to be a series.
And nobody else had ever done anything.
It's never been done before.
Right.
You know, I found a little niche inside the metalsmithing world that hadn't been addressed, and now I've kind of covered that, and I'm sure that that book is going to become kind of a mainstay of any metalsmithing teaching that goes forward from now, because it's the first time that whole thing's been written out.
Right.
But I did have a book that came out in 2001, which was basically an artist book, you know, about my work. And that book has made an enormous difference in my credibility as an artist and opportunities that have come from it and everything like that. But both of these books have turned me into basically a writer. So I spend a lot of time now writing, and I'm working on a third book, Design for Survival, Entrepreneurial Thinking and Tactics for Artists.
Okay, so so you're writing, you're making jewelry, you're an artist, so you do installations.
Right.
and you have Studio Flux, which is the teaching side.
Yeah, so. Studio Flux is our little school and also our workshop brand. And up until this past year, it was just me going out around the country teaching workshops wherever.
Right.
Sometimes in jewelry studios, sometimes in function rooms and hotels, at art retreats, at craft schools, things like that. But last year we converted what was my sculpture studio in the back of our building at 1810 Magazine Street into a workshop giving space.
Right.
And so, I mean, I just recently taught a workshop on soldering, you know, for six people. And ongoingly we have workshops that go every couple of days, you know.
Well, inside your class now, how do you as the artist relate what you're teaching back to the student, and then how do you have your art come through again?
Yeah. Well, the interesting thing is that right now is that where I'm just basically teaching basic classes.
Right.
I don't have classes yet where we've gotten to kind of like the design level of things. And I'm hoping to bring enough people along locally so that we get to a point where people are say, okay, I know how to solder, I know how to saw, I know how to do all this stuff. Okay, now how about design?
Right.
Where does that come in? And that will be the next big challenge about how you communicate that particular, you know, understanding.
Well, you take your art and you design it in a small scale,
yes.
But then you can expand it up into
right.
any size. So
yeah.
Basically what starts out as a piece of jewelry can end up being a monumental public sculpture.
Absolutely.
How do you think about all that stuff? Is that something that you know going into the piece, or that you have these possibilities? Or?
Oh, well, sometimes yes, and sometimes no. Sometimes it's just jewelry and it has to be designed to be wearable.
Right.
And other times I can design it to be wearable, but maybe not so wearable as it would be if it were lighter with or a pair of earrings or something like that. Mostly the best sculptural mechanism in jewelry is basically pins and brooches.
Okay.
Because they're floating on a surface. And so when I design those things, then I think, oh yes, these can be expanded, and I have done that very successfully. The real trick here is that my ability as the small object maker, the metal fabricator, the jewelry designer, makes me really good at making objects that can be scaled up, because all of the connections and all of the mechanisms about how the thing are put together are demonstrated in the small piece and can be duplicated at scale.
Right.
That's the real trick.
Right.
You know.
So of all these things that you do, what is rising to the surface now is the thing you like to do most? Is it still design and creating your stuff, and what kind of materials do you like to work with in that arena, or are you finding the writing becoming more pleasurable?
Well, no, the writing is very challenging.
Okay.
And it has produced in me an enormous respect for anyone who decides they're going to be a writer, because it is the most challenging creative thing I think anybody could choose to do.
Right.
It's much easier for me to solder wire together and cut sheets of metal, and to me that's a no-brainer.
Right.
You know, the writing side of it takes another part of your brain and makes you, it's really, really involved. It exhausts me, actually, when I'm doing it. So. The real challenge for me is to focus on a material or a technique or a design mode that seems to be making sense at the moment, you know,
right.
And to kind of have the time to invest in that. And quite frankly, I am so busy that it's really become fairly difficult. I mean, I have to calendar studio time.
Right, right.
Right?
Well, you know, tell us a little bit about Gallery.io
and then.
You know, go into that a little bit.
Well, Gallery.io, I opened the gallery in 1989 basically as a place where I could deliver to the New Orleans art community the work of contemporary jewelry designers that I knew from around the country and around the world, because at that point there was no other venue for it in the city. And I believe that Gallery.io has been very successful in elevating the general public's understanding of what contemporary jewelry work is. And it continues to function in that way. It's a showcase for my own work, of course.
Right.
But we show
the
work of 30 or 40 other people in there on a fairly regular basis. And then we have theme shows periodically, you know, like we're going to do the Martini 3 show in October for Art for Art's Sake, which is, you know, we send a stainless steel martini glass out to 40 or 50 artists around the country, you know, and some foreign artists as well. and they alter them and send them back, and we have a wonderful little opening with
and
them.
And then everybody gets to drink out of them.
Yeah, yeah, so exactly.
That makes it even happier.
Yeah, yeah. So we do things like that, the theme shows occasionally through the year. Right. So the gallery really does a wonderful job of keeping us present on a bricks and mortar way, you know.
And then Studio Flux is in there as well.
It's in the back of the gallery, yes.
So someone wanting to get involved in becoming a student of Thomas Mann and learning all these wonderful things that you do, how would they go about doing
they
that?
Can, if they're local, they can stop into the gallery at 1810 Magazine Street anytime, and we'll...
And that's the same address as Gallery I.
Oh, it's 1812, but it's the same building.
Okay, so that's where everybody could come in and buy fabulous
And of
design.
Course, it's all online at thomasmann.com.
Right. Okay, cool. Right. Well, have you found that the website has driven a lot of business over the brick and mortar? I know a lot of people are going there now. A lot of marketing is done virally, and people are making these big pushes into website commerce. And I know, you know, we're contemporaries, so this is all stuff that we have to pull ourselves along into. Have you?
Well, we were. I have to say that we were pretty far ahead of the curve because I've had a e-commerce website since the middle '90s. And that website initially didn't really produce much in terms of our retail income, but now it's a substantial part of what we do. There's been an evolution that's taken place. They said that when the web was 50-50 male-female, you would see an evolution of the e-commerce side of the whole thing, and that has proven to be true. And they said that that happened in 2003. You know, so our website is real critical to our overall survival as a small company. And we ship things to... I mean, yesterday we shipped things to Australia, and New Zealand, and England. You know, we ship all over the world. You know, it's amazing.
Well Tom, you've given us a lot of stuff. I think people have learned a lot more about you than they knew before. I think that they'll have a wonderful time coming down to see you at the shop and hopefully signing up for the classes.
Yeah, thanks so much.
So thank you so much for being here, and we will be right back.
Imagine America's largest stage, dark. Or the nation's biggest schoolhouse, empty. Or the greatest library of documentary programming, closed forever. It could happen if funding for PBS is eliminated. Find out more about the threat to PBS at 170millionamericans.org.
Welcome back. Made in New Orleans is a show about creative people, and we're really lucky tonight to have a very creative thinker that's rethinking and redesigning downtown living in New Orleans. I'd like you to welcome Marcel Wisnia. Marcel, thanks for being on the show.
Steve, it's my pleasure. Thank you. I'm flattered to be here.
Well, we've got a few minutes to talk about what you do, so why don't we start there? Tell us about your firm and the vision that you have for what you do.
I'm an architect and a real estate developer, and I've practiced in New Orleans since 1973. But what's always been of interest to me is the real estate side of our practice. And it's always been a small part of our practice, and since Hurricane Katrina, I felt the best way I could be part of the recovery of the city was to really flip-flop our business model and really to make the majority of the work that we do and that we focus on our own development work. I also believe that in order for New Orleans to survive, in order for New Orleans to prosper, we've got to create a safe city. And when I say safe, I don't mean from crime.
Right. We had talked a little bit about this earlier, vertical living.
Right. We believe that in order to have a city that can survive future hurricanes or other disasters, that people have to live off the ground. And what better place to do that than in downtown New Orleans?
Right. Well, that's a new phenomenon for New Orleans, but it's been done in larger cities where they've redeveloped the downtowns and revitalized them through taking older structures and putting them into a new use. And you've done that with several buildings. I think your first was Union Lofts. Can you tell us about, you know, where you started with that and where you want to go?
Well, Union Lofts is a small 50,000 square foot, four-story building in the heart of downtown. And it was an office building, and it was actually a building that had been vacant for probably 15 years.
Wasn't it a telegraph?
It was the old Western Union Telegraph building. And so we took that building and we turned it into a mixed-use development, primarily residential. And I use the term mixed use because really in downtown developments, you don't want to create one use. You want to create a 24-hour city. And in order to do that, the ground floor has a certain use, and that brings people, that creates activity. And then what better use for the upper floors but residential?
Right. Now, you used art there too. And that's something that is the reason that you're on the show primarily is because of your use of art in your projects. Why don't you tell us a little bit about how that got started?
Well, certainly art and architecture have always been important to one another. And we used the Union Lofts project to really showcase art as part of the architecture and enhance the architecture. And it's 33 individual apartments, each one are fully furnished. And we commissioned an artist to do an individual art piece in each of the 33 units. Now, what really got me thinking was that if I lived in that building and I knew what art piece was in my apartment, I would be curious to know what was in the other 32. So we took the images of all 33 of them, we shrunk them to about 8x10, and we put them in the hallways and created a mini gallery within the hallways.
And that's something in a big way with another building that you've just done called the Saratoga. And you have the Saratoga Collection. That's been nationally publicized.
Well, we worked with an artist and a curator by the name of Terrence Sanders. And Terrence put together 64 individual art pieces from 41 emerging artists.
And some of those artists are like Skylar Finn, Alex Podesta.
Alex Podesta with his bunnies.
Stephen Collier.
We've got Bruce Davenport. So a series of people that really, since we started collecting, are coming into their own.
Right. They were relatively unknown before.
Exactly.
Right.
So we've taken these 64 pieces of art and we have spread them throughout the building in the public areas. We've treated it like a museum, and we actually call the development Saratoga the Apartment Museum. So we really have used art to enhance the architecture. And what's interesting to me is to watch the residents, watch the people living there, and watch them embrace the art. And again, as being a curious person, if I lived on one floor and I knew what the art was like on my floor, am I going to take the time to investigate the art and all the other floors? Well, we encourage people to do that by taking the elevators and putting images of the art in the elevators. We have four elevators and we have two images in each elevator. So in eight instances, you can see what's on each, some of the other floors.
Well, you've not only done that in the building, but you've reached out to the street with your new bus stop that you've created in front of it. And then a commercial application where I think you had a space that you wanted to bring people to for eating and dining, coffee and such, and you ended up creating your own store called
Merchant.
Right.
So we have a little coffee shop. Actually, our tagline is Coffee, Crepes, and Grapes. Serves Ely Coffee. It's on the ground floor of the Maritime Building of one of our developments. And it has been highly successful. We took an alleyway that had fallen into disrepair, actually a public space, a covered historic little alley that was separating our building from an adjacent building. We went to the city and we negotiated a long-term lease on that space. We brought it back to life. We use it for seating, and we actually have an art collection, a secondary art collection in that space.
Now, you have a new project. Would you want to talk about the new downtown living that you've got envisioned for cars and green living?
Well, we own a building called the Stevens Garage, and it's the old Stevens Chevrolet. And again, it's located on Carondelet Street. And we have taken out all the, this is conceptual right now, we'll start construction by the beginning of 2013. But we've taken out all of the car ramps. We've added two car elevators. So if you live there and you come home by car, you drive your car into an elevator, takes you up to the floor you live on, the other door opens, you drive out and you literally park in front of your apartment.
That's going to be cool.
It's going to be very cool, but probably the coolest part about it is that we are utilizing the state of Louisiana renewable energy tax credit, and we'll have about 160 kilowatt solar array on the roof, so every resident will benefit from it, and about 60% of their utility needs will be generated by the sun. If you have a plug-in hybrid or an electric car, you'll have a charging station, and you'll also get that that charge will be generated by the sun.
Well, there's so many things that you've done, so many things that you're doing. Why don't you tell people how they can come and see it? Do you have a website where they can look at this stuff? Can they come down and take self-tours of the Saratoga collection? I know they can have coffee at Merchant because I do almost every day.
Mm-hmm. Well, again, our firm is called Wisnia Architecture and Development, and Wisnia is a strange name. It's spelled W-I-S as in Sam, Z as in Zebra, N as in Nancy, I-A. So people can go to Wisnia.com. Wisnia.com will lead them to a series of other websites, but most of them share a commonality in the fact that, for instance, our maritime website is themaritimeneworleans.com. Our Saratoga site is thesaratoganeworleans.com. We have a great shared workspace that we created in the maritime building that's called Beta, B-E-T-A. We've just done something creative there where we just put out our first phone app. So now you can go on your iPhone and book a space in Beta, a collaborative workspace.
Right. Well, Marcel, thank you so much for coming down today and talking with us. I appreciate it. There's a lot of good things that you're doing and a lot of things that people can see. And we'll be right back. It looks like we've run out of time today. Thanks for joining us. I'm Steve Martin for Made in New Orleans. Please remember to support the arts.
Made in New Orleans is made possible by Art New Orleans Magazine, your one source for art, culture, and entertainment. More information is available online at artneworleansmag.com.